Derrick, you know, I think when Matthew Ho resigned just recently, I think it kind of shot it shot across the bow a little bit to this Obama administration that they really better think seriously about their plan for Afghanistan. I mean, here's a guy, you know, joined the Foreign Service, ex-military, Marine Corps captain, served in combat in Iraq, senior U.S. civilian advisor in Kabul, and he says, look, we've got it all wrong. And basically, your Rethink Afghanistan piece says exactly what he says. It says we shouldn't even be there. He says that what we're doing is destabilizing Afghanistan even more. And it's got to cause this president to say, look, who am I really getting the best advice from?
Sure. You know, if you look at where Matthew served, his service record, I mean, he's a decorated Marine captain, as you said. He served in Anbar in Iraq.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Anbar's been kind of pushed by the pro-counterinsurgency crowd as some sort of model that we can export then to Afghanistan. But here you've got this guy who's been in both places, and he's telling you very clearly that we are past the point where American military might is going to, you know, affect some magical change in widespread cultural values, in a deteriorating security situation that has worsened commensurate with our continued troop increases since 2001. I mean, it really is telling that in order to try to keep him out of a kind of public critique role, that Holbrooke and I believe Eikenberry offered him a job to try to keep him inside the fold. Yeah. I mean, this is someone whose opinion they obviously really need to take seriously.
Yeah, it's respected opinion. I mean, and so Obama, to ignore what this young man says, is insane. He said, basically says the same thing you do in your article, Rethink Afghanistan, which is it's not really a war of troops. How do we ignore what happened with the Brits? How do we ignore what happened with Russians, Macedonia, on and on? It's not the kind of war that people have had much success winning.
So
what do we do about Afghanistan? What's the 10,000 foot in your way of thinking? What do we do?
Well, I mean, first it's important to look at what you don't do, right? So we look at our experience over the last several years, and we know economically that the U.S. cannot afford to deepen its military commitment in Afghanistan. We're talking $1 million per troop per year, $400 per tank of gas expended in Afghanistan. I mean, huge costs. And we've increased troops every single year since our involvement there began. And since we've started systematically tracking civilian casualties, we've seen them rise commensurately every year that we've tracked those casualties. We've seen an insurgency spreading. We've seen the insurgency following around our revamped supply lines. And we are not safer due to what we're doing right now. So, I mean, the first thing we need to do is stop, take a breath, and realize that more and harder of the same thing isn't getting us anywhere. It's actually getting us in the hole.
It is impossible to watch Brave New Films' series of videos called Rethink Afghanistan and walk away and say, yeah, that's a good idea. We need to be there. I mean, you would almost have to be brain dead to watch those films and conclude that we're on the right path here.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, it's not just Brave New Foundation saying this. I mean, you've got folks, like we said, like Matthew Ho, who've been there. But if you look at folks like the Carnegie Institute for International Peace, right? They've been saying for quite some time, since before the first escalation, that you escalate in Afghanistan at your own risk, and that the principal driver of the insurgency has been the deepening U.S. troop presence.
What do you mean? What do you mean by that? Fill that out a little bit more.
Sure. Well, I mean, if you look at Matthew's letter that he submitted, I mean, it's a great four-page.
It
destroys the arguments.
Mm-hmm.
There is a view among folks in Afghanistan who live there, among the Pashtun population, that their land and their culture has been under sustained, continuous assault by outside powers for a vast stretch of history.
It's accurate, too.
It is. I mean, it's very accurate, actually. I mean, you know, and you look at that kind of analysis, right, coming from inside Afghanistan, and then you look at somebody like Matthew saying, you know, that's what he's seeing. It's not just something that Matthew's saying either. You know, the DFID, it's Britain's development arm, put out a report where they surveyed folks who were in insurgency-prone areas. They surveyed more than 100 people. And what those people found, or what they found from those people, rather, were that nobody buys the U.S. rationale for the occupation. They think there's another nefarious motive, and that they're not primarily motivated by a message of religious radicalism. Rather, that they become religiously radicalized after they've joined.
Why don't we just say why we're there? I mean, look, here's the argument. The argument, there's several arguments. I think probably the only one that makes any sense at all is that we're there to own that land between Pakistan and Iran. We've got Pakistan, who really does have nuclear arms. I mean, no question, they have nuclear arms. Iran is on their way to nuclear arms. The argument being, if any type of militia were of any sort were to take over control of those countries, then all of a sudden you have terrorists with nuclear arms. And the only place to fight that intelligently is, obviously it's not Iraq, is Afghanistan. Now, you've heard that argument, I know. What's your response?
Well, my response is kind of similar to one given by Roy Stewart, who is in the Rethink Afghanistan series and in the documentary. He gave testimony the other day to Congress where he said basically the rationale that you hear from folks who say that we have to be in Afghanistan because of the situation in Pakistan is like saying you can't fight a tiger, so you're going to kick this cat. And because
right.
we know the
rather than confronting that, Pakistan.
Yeah, yeah. You're going to hit the cat some more. And right. and we know that the moment American boots hit the ground in Pakistan, that place will light up like a fireworks stand with a match thrown in. We know that. And so the rationale has been that, well, we can't, you know, if we leave Afghanistan, they're going to have a safe haven. It'll destabilize Pakistan. But, you know, you've had really expert people like Paul Pillar. He's ex-CIA. He's over at Georgetown now. He went before Congress here recently and said that, you know, even if you went 100% with the McChrystal plan, which is a massive escalation,
oh, yeah.
you're still not going to be able to control anything but very limited areas of Afghanistan. You're still going to be leaving huge swaths of land open. And so the idea that some kind of counterinsurgency that isn't going to be, you know, 500,000 U.S. troops on the ground is going to deny a safe haven is ludicrous, even at its most extreme argument that's being made here.
Yeah, so the control of land doesn't sell for you.
No, not at all.
Derrick, let's take a quick break. We're going to be right back with the idea of rethinking Afghanistan and hoping like hell that Obama gets the message here. We'll be right back.